Macmillan Audio presents Good Boy, written by Jennifer Finney Boylan, read by Kelsey Navarro, with a short introductory note read by Jennifer Finney Boylan.
Cave Canem. In a handful of instances in this book, I've used pseudonyms for some of the humans in order to protect the privacy of the dogs. Parts of the story first appeared in very different form in The New Yorker and The New York Times. I'm grateful to my editors there, Sharon Shetty, Clay Risen, and Jim Dow, for their support and patience, as well as to Deb Futter at Celadon, who edited She's Not There in 2003 and returns to me now like a long-lost sister. I'm always grateful to hear from readers and listeners. My email is jb@jenniferboylan.net.
Introduction. Too dark to read. I took her picture one sparkling autumn day, as she stood in our dirt road waiting. There was a bright red maple leaf on the ground. A year later, I held that photo in my hands as the tears rolled down. An Eva Cassidy ballad, Autumn Leaves, played on the radio. It was an old, sad song. My children had been 12 and 10 back in 2006. Our family had been through a wrenching couple of years. And yet, we'd emerged on the other side of those days still together. The four of us plus Ranger, the black lab. Our lives revolved around that dog and each other. But we worried that Ranger felt puny when we weren't around. Sometimes we arrived back at the house to hear him howling piteously. It was heartbreaking, his loneliness. Then, someone emailed us about this dog named Indigo. She'd had puppies a few months before, and now she needed a home. Were the Boylans interested? The Boylans were. Indigo joined us as Ranger's wing dog. When she first stepped through the door, her underbelly still showed the recent signs of the litter she'd delivered. Between the wise, droopy face and the swinging dog teats, she was a sight to behold. She had a nose for trouble. On one occasion, I came home to find that she'd eaten a 5-pound bag of flour. She was covered in white powder. The flour print paws were everywhere, including, incredibly, the countertops. I asked the dog what the hell had happened, and Indy just looked at me with a glance that said, "I cannot imagine what you are referring to." Time passed. Our children grew up and went off to college. I left my job at Colby College in Maine and joined the faculty at Barnard. My mother died at age 94. The mirror, which had reflected a young mom when Indigo first barged through the door, now showed a woman in late middle age. I had surgery for cataracts. I began to lose my hearing. We all turned gray. Me, my spouse, the dogs. That summer, I took Indigo for one last walk. She was slow and unsteady on her paws. She looked up at me mournfully. "You did say you'd take care of me when the time came," she said. "You promised." She died on an August afternoon, a tennis ball at her side. Sometimes in the weeks that followed, I'd find myself searching for her, as if she might be sleeping in one of my children's empty bedrooms. But she wasn't there. What was I looking for as I poked around the house? Was it really the dog I'd lost? By the time you're in your 50s, a lot of things have flown. You learn to make peace with ghosts, but it's an uneasy truce at best. I'd sit in my children's bedrooms now and again and get all mopey about the fact that they'd become adults so swiftly. Here were the talismans of their childhood, finger paintings from pre-K, an old soccer ball, college diplomas. The rooms reminded me of a photograph I'd once seen of the tomb of Tutankhamun, with the relics of the boy king's life, a golden mask, an ancient checkerboard, strewn around the burial chamber. They lay where they'd been left, 3,000 years before. I'd been their mother for 17 years, but 4 years before that, I'd been a father, a boyfriend, a child. I had never regretted coming out as trans, living in the world without shame or secrets. But there were times when I remembered my younger self the way you'd remember a dear friend you'd lost, for reasons you no longer quite understood. Where was that boy? That adorable nerd who'd spent his days sitting on the banks of a stream in Pennsylvania, fishing for brook trout. I wondered, sometimes, what had become of him. Would it be necessary, in the days to come, to refer to him only in scare quotes? My days have been numbered in dogs. Even now, when I try to take the measure of the people I have been, I count the years by the dogs I owned in each season. When I was a boy, for instance, I had a Dalmatian named Playboy, a resentful hoodlum who loved no one except my father. Later, as a hippie teenager, I had another Dalmatian, a mournful, swollen creature named Sausage. While I was off at Wesleyan, becoming insufferably cool, my sister brought a mutt named Matt home from Carleton, a dog whose insatiable sex drive and accompanying disregard for the rule of law made it abundantly clear that he was determined, as they say in Ireland, to live a life given over totally to pleasure. Still later, during my years as a nascent hipster in New York, my family acquired a lab named Brown, whose only true devotion was to eating her own paws, a pastime that obsessed the dog as if her feet were a rarity more succulent than Clams Casino. In my 30s, as a young husband, I adopted a Gordon Setter named Alex, a wise soul who stood watch over my wife and me right up until the day our first child was born. And then, as a father, I shared a house with Lucy, a retriever chow chow mashup who wasted exactly zero time in making clear her utter contempt for me, for our children, for all of us. We'd come home each day to find the dog in a state of cynicism and disapproval. "Oh," she'd say, just like Tony Soprano's mother, "look who calls." It was Lucy who was on duty the day I finally came down the stairs in heels. She looked me up and down with exhaustion. "Ugh," she said, "I wish the Lord would take me now." Actually, a lot of people reacted like that at first, including many of the men and women I had loved most. When we talk about dogs, it is not uncommon for people to say things like, "They love us unconditionally. Their hearts are so pure." But to be honest, I have rarely found this to be the case. When I was a boy, for instance, there was a German shepherd named Gomer who lived on a farm near our house. Most of his days were spent at the end of a heavy iron chain. If he'd been given the option, it was clear enough. Gomer would have torn me apart like a Walmart pinata. The only thing unconditional about Gomer's feelings toward me was his bottomless hate. But his owner, Joy, saw him as an adorable rascal. "Who's a good boy?" she asked the terrible Gomer, feeding him a piece of raw steak she'd obtained specifically for this purpose. "Who's a good boy?" In the years since, I have known lots of people whose love has been focused solely on other questionable creatures, some of them evil, such as Gomer, and others just sad and floppy. Dogs with all the sentience of a used ShamWow. But oh, the adoration that my friends have had for these waffly creatures, and with what profound devotion they've arranged their days around their needs. One friend of mine has a dog that is kind of like a miniature sloth, with unsettling bits of dried-up alpo congealed into the fur around its mouth. A creature whose paws, for reasons I do not understand, can never touch the ground, and who must be carried like a clutch purse from spot to spot. She calls him her little man. She's always telling me about how much Bingo loves her, how Bingo's the only one who understands her, how her life would be empty were it not for the radiant adoration little Bingo sends forth. I am not in the business of questioning the love that anyone has for anyone else. So let's agree. Whatever she and Bingo have going on is their own sweet business. But if you ask me, the magic of dogs is not that their love for us is unconditional. What's unconditional is the love that we have for them. Listen, if we're going to talk about dogs, we're going to have to talk about love. And the sooner you get your mind around this, the more irritated with me you can be. I'll try to be brief. I'm pretty sure that if there is any reason why we are here on this planet, it is in order to love one another. It is, as the saying goes, all ye known on earth and all ye need to know. And yet, as it turns out, nothing is harder than loving human beings. In part, this is because we don't know what we want. Or on those unlikely occasions when we do know what we want, we often don't know how to put our desire into words. Instead, a lot of the time we act like my old friend Gomer, snarling and slathering at the end of our chains, driven to fury not only by our imprisonment, but also by the presence of others who appear to us to be undeservedly walking free. A lot of the time, the one thing we're here to do is the thing that we're actually not at all that good at. When we try to express the thing we feel, most of the time it comes out wrong. No, wait. I have found myself saying over and over again, perhaps more than any other phrase I have uttered in this life, that's not what I meant. On the other hand, given how inarticulate we are in the language of love, we're absolutely fluent when it comes to expressing our hate. This is a book about dogs, the love we have for them and the way that love helps us understand the people we have been. This is a book about men and boys, written by a woman who remembers the world in which they lived the way an emigrant might, late in life, recall the distant country of her birth. Back when I lived in the old country, like many men, there were times I found it impossible to express the thing that was in my heart. But the love I felt for dogs was one I never had cause to hide. This is a book about seven phases of my life and the dogs I loved at each moment. It's in the love of dogs, and my love for them, that I can best now take the measure of that vanished boy and his endless desire. There are times when it is hard for me to fully remember that mysterious child, his ferocity, and his fragility. Sometimes he seems to fade before me, like breath on a mirror. But I remember the dogs. It's worth noting what happened on the one day Gomer finally got the thing he'd always wanted, by which I mean my throat. Gomer's mistress, Joy, was the manager of a stable. There, my sister rode horses and hung out with stable boys who mucked the stalls and listened to the Rolling Stones on a transistor radio. I was just a scarecrow in those days, hanging around the barn with my partner in crime, an older boy named Jimmy. That was my name, too, back then anyway. And we were like two mobsters. Jimmy Slingshot, him, and Jimmy Flytrap, me. We shot wasp nests with slingshots. We crept around the perimeter of the nearby Delaware County prison and watched the convicts planting corn in their orange jumpsuits. We walked across farmers' fields with his dog Fleece, who had only one eye. We sat in the leather seats of his brother's stock car, a coupe that sat up on blocks in the slingshot family's garage. Its front fender was crushed from an accident during the last race the brother had run. The brother, Bob Jr., wasn't around anymore. Now he was in Vietnam, flying a chopper. While he was away, Jimmy Slingshot's father, Bob Sr., who had worked at Boeing developing the very chopper that his son was now flying, turned completely gray. One day, Jimmy Slingshot and I came upon a huge pile of dead pigs in a field. Flies swarmed around them. What did we do? Just what you'd expect. We got out our slingshots and shot pebbles at the carcasses, that being the custom among our people. I would, of course, have rather been back at our house, secretly experimenting with my mother's pink plastic rollers. But how could a person put this desire into words? The only thing you could do with such a yearning, even if it was, ultimately, the utter truth of your being, was to keep it locked down in a hole. Or so I then thought. In the afternoon, I left his house and went looking for my sister, who was supposed to be currycombing her pony, Iris, down by the barn. In order to get there, though, I had to walk through Joy's farm, a place that had clearly once been a thriving enterprise but had fallen on some strange misfortune. The biggest of the old barns had burned down decades before, and it now stood collapsed in on itself. A tangle of stone foundations and charred timbers. A series of old stone steps led from Jimmy Slingshot's house, down a hill and into the heart of the old farm's ruins. A complex that included not only the barn with my sister's pony, but Joy's home too. A stone farmhouse surrounded by mud well pocked with hoofprints. Gomer sat at his usual sentry post, the top step of Joy's front porch. A chain dangled from his neck. I tried to slip by him without making eye contact. The dog hated nothing more than eye contact. But I heard the deep growl, and I froze, hoping against hope that motionlessness would make me less contemptible in his sight. In this, I was wrong. Gomer leapt to his feet and barked at me with anger and contempt. Again and again he lunged, only to be yanked back by his chain. I felt my heart pounding. I was certain I knew why the dog hated me. It was because he could see into my heart. "I know who you are," he snarled. "I know who you are." There were times when I figured everybody knew who I was. That I was not Jimmy Flytrap at all. That I was, in fact, Jenny Twinset. I really believed this, right up until the day I finally came out, some 30 years later.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.